Sarah, thank you. We know fire crews have their hands more than full battling a number of wildfires here in the Bay Area and across the state right now. We've been monitoring a series of fires, including the Hennessy and Gamble fires up in Napa County. There are also the Deer Zone fires just south of Brentwood, then the Marsh Fire north of Milpitas. We're also learning about a new fire this morning in the North Bay. It's being called the 1510 fire. Let's discuss how emergency crews are responding to this during the COVID-19 pandemic. We are happy to welcome back to the 9 former FEMA coordinator Mark Nouveau. Thanks for being with us.
Good morning, Garcia, Sal, Mike. It's nice to see y'all.
It's good to have you. A lot of questions. Let's start with the big picture as it stands. Tell us how resources here in California and the Bay Area are faring with this much activity.
Yeah, huge. There's so much going on right now. The National Interagency Fire Center, which is in Boise, Idaho, they manage all wildfires when they get to a certain level across the country. They have planning levels from 1 through 5. We're at planning level 4, 5 being the most severe. So we're seeing a stretch in the number of resources, hand crews, their challenge with COVID-19, budgetary cutbacks, record temperatures. It's going to be a very, very difficult 24, 48 hours.
The areas that are burning here in the Bay Area, sadly, are no stranger to wildfires. In years past, we've seen fire start in hot, dry, windy conditions. This weather pattern is completely different. How does that affect the firefight?
Yeah, completely to your point. Absolutely, Garcia. What we saw yesterday hadn't happened for 50 years, and that was the number of lightning strikes. And really, that's what this is all about, is the lightning strikes up and down the state, both in Southern California. 94 fires within one day. There were 21 fires in 1 hour in the Butte Ranger Unit up in Northern California, which is the same county where the Paradise Fire was. So we're right back into those areas, as well as the areas in the Bay Area that you're talking about.
I know you've seen a number of just stunning pictures of lightning strikes, fires that have started as a result. I'd like to pull in one still picture in particular that shows a lightning strike, almost unlike any I've seen before in the East Bay. Let's talk about what's happening in this picture.
Yeah, isn't that incredible? That was taken by some of the folks on the fire line, and that was in Livermore yesterday. And you can see just the lightning strikes hitting the ground, the fire running across there. That gives you a good idea of how beautiful nature is, but also how devastating it can be. It's a wonderful picture that they captured there.
It really does, you know, it's such an ominous view, but you have to understand there are people who are being told to stay inside their homes. They're sweltering. Some may not have power due to either rolling blackouts or other problems with electricity. Just the process of evacuations we've seen has been clunky in years past. What's happening with that kind of notification now?
Well, they're getting better at it. You know, they've got alert system of cameras throughout the state now that we didn't have before, so you can get some early warning going. No question about that. People are more in tune to knowing how to get advice and counsel. The county's emergency management departments are better at getting that notice out there. But again, to your point, and the challenge is if PG&E starts to shut off power, that just compounds it. It might not be in the area where the fires are at, but that could hamper domestic water supply, the ability to notify people because their radio or television out. The power shutoffs, although the good news is yesterday, Californians conserved enough to not have it. There is worry over the next 3 days we may experience that. And that can compound the firefighting efforts. It makes it just one more challenge on top of COVID-19.
Well, and so let's talk about the pandemic, right? I can't believe it's, you know, my fourth question to you, but how is COVID-19 affecting the firefight? Usually you see firefighters, you know, brothers and sisters, shoulder to shoulder, they're fighting the fire. I can't imagine that's the case.
Yeah, what's happened is each fire that's managed by whatever team, incident management team, on the front page of what they call an incident action plan are their management by objectives. The number one in all of those plans on the top of the page, front page, is to utilize COVID-19 guidelines. So what that means is 6-foot spacing. When you're bunking down, you got to space out. But all of that presents challenges when you're trying to be safe, make sure you've got an eye, have lookouts, so they can operate in that manner. But when it becomes critical, in terms of safety, there are some challenges there. What we also know is that the hand crews in the state of California, which at one time numbered 190, are down to 70. And that's a critical component on the initial attack of fires. It's a crew that gets in there with, you know, axes and picks, and they're firing out and they're clearing. They're very, very effective. And CAL FIRE wants to use that resource, but we've got less of them because of COVID-19. And many of these crews were inmate crews, and they were low offenders, so they were released out of different jails and prisons. So that's reduced the number of hand crews available, and it makes it more challenging to be able to get in and attack these fires early.
Well, I mean, I'll tell you, Mark, it's an overused word, but I have to use it on this one. It's an unprecedented situation. Mark Nouveau, thank you again for joining us this morning.
You're welcome. Have a great day, Gossie. It's nice to see you.